really love my Kindle, and I've been using it over the last few years, over the generations of upgrades that this Kindle has had. And I like it because of two main reasons. Firstly, the display is obviously dynamic, which makes it much, much lighter to carry than physical books. And secondly, because it uses the e-ink screen technology, the battery lasts for weeks. So today, I'm really, really excited to explore this tiny, tiny WaveShare e-ink module that I intend to use for my current project. Now, thankfully, because of the internet, there are already many resources on how to use this WaveShare e-ink module. Hence, for today's video, I'll be focusing on how to use this module potentially on a future PCB. And that's why we'll be focusing on three things. Number one, it will be the firmware, which will be the Arduino firmware. Number two, it will be the exact pin connections, which we can connect from the module or even the display by itself to the microcontroller. And number three, just for fun, we will dive into the SPI communication protocol that this e-ink screen module uses. So I got this e-ink screen module from the WaveShare website, and I got the tiniest one, which is 1.5 inch. And there are variants of it. The first one is just the display panel, which we can use on the PCB. The second one is the module, which comes as a breakout board, and it makes it easy to connect the pins to the microcontroller. For the first step, let's look at the firmware. And we are going to use three different types of development board to flash in the firmware so that we can display something on this tiny little e-ink screen. Now, if we want to use the Arduino firmware, thankfully, WaveShare has already open sourced it. And under the repository called ePaper, we will dive into the folder called Arduino because that's what we are using. We are not using Raspberry Pi or STM32 microcontroller. And inside the Arduino directory, you will see many, many other folders. These basically correspond to the various types of displays that we have here on WaveShare. So for our purpose, the module that I bought is simply 1.54 inch. It is not version 2. It is not version B or C. And once I go inside this directory, this is where we will find the C files, the header files, and also the Arduino.ino file. It can be a little daunting to look at so many files, but let's focus on three pairs of files. So I will copy these three pairs of files into a completely empty directory right here. And there you have it. So basically, I've just copied the three pairs of files. The next thing we are going to do is to create the Arduino .ino file. So for this, I'm just going to create eink.ino. And right at the top, we will include three header files. The one is for SPI, and the other two are the header files that comes with the WaveShare Arduino. After this, let's have some initializations. So we will define the colored pixels and the uncolored pixels, along with some global variables right here. And after that, of course, we have the setup and the loop. In fact, we will not be using the loop at all, so we will just focus on the setup function. The very first thing we will do in the setup function is to check whether the e-ink screen is actually available and kind of print out if the initialization of the e-paper failed. The next thing we have to do is clear the memory, and we have to kind of clear it twice because this is how the WaveShare e-ink module works. And next is where the fun begins. We will firstly set the rotation of the screen to zero and set the width and the height in terms of pixels. It will be just 200 by 24. And finally, we will write our hello world. And they are basically in three lines. Firstly, we will clear and say that give me all the uncolored pixels. And let's draw at, say, x-axis 10 and y-axis number 4. Hello world with font size 16 in colored, so our text will be black, and then basically we will set this frame memory. In case you're wondering where these functions are coming from, well, they are coming from the header files that we acquired right at the top. And the final thing we need to do is display frame, of course, and then we will give it a delay of maybe about 2 seconds. And this is the cool part. We will make it sleep. And that's about it. But we are missing a few functions. The first one is the font size 16. If we come back to the GitHub, we will see that there are various other types of fonts, but all we need to do is, of course, the font header file. And for our purpose, we will just get the font 16.c. So here, let me just copy and paste two more files. And I've acquired the font 16 files here. And as always, I use the makefile to flash in, so I'll just copy and paste some make commands to ensure that we are flashing into the port and Arduino Uno. For the second step, we will look at the actual hardware pin configurations, meaning the pins that are found in the WaveShare module, how exactly are they going to connect to the microcontroller or the dev boards that we have. Now, if you look at the module that I'm using, there are basically 8 pins, but we're going to divide it into 3 groups. The first board that we are going to look at is the Arduino Uno with Atmega 328. And so among the 8 pins, of course, the 2 pins will be the ground and the VCC. Now the VCC in this case is connected to the 3.3 volts output of the Arduino Uno board. And the ground can also be connected basically to the ground. The next two pins that are easy to look at are the clock and the MOSI, the master out slave in pins, because this is where the SPI interface pins come into picture. So if we wonder where these pins are defined, we can actually go to the Arduino reference for SPI, and if we look at the specific board, which is Uno in our case, we will see that the clock pin is 13, and we are using MOSI because we are only doing a data output from the Arduino Uno to the E-ink screen. So it is D11. So D13 and D11. And finally, there are 4 other pins. If we come back to our firmware, this is exactly where they're defined. The reset, the DC, the CS, and the busy pin. The last 4 pins we need to configure. And they are basically D8, D9, D10, and D7. So I have split the screen. As you can see that this is the E-Ink, the WaveShare module. This is the Arduino Uno. And right here, I have all the code with the files. So why don't we try to flash it in? So I'm just going to do a make and see whether any errors occur. And if we are good, there you see the screen is flashing. And hello world. Well, why don't we go ahead and add one more line. And maybe in this case, we will just do ePaper plus Uno onto another line. So it should be 30. So let's try this one more time and flash in the firmware. Notice the E-Ink screen, and it will flash slightly for the refresh. And there you see, hello world, ePaper plus Uno. Now that was Arduino Uno. Why don't we try to make it work with the M0 or the one containing the microcontroller at SAMD21G. And you will see that how similar they are in concepts, but we need to also take note of the exact pin configurations in this case. For the second microcontroller, which is SAMD21G, I am using the DevBoard Robodyne M0. And as you can see, I have already wired up the E-Ink screen with Robodyne. First group will definitely be the 3.3 volts and the ground that we are going to connect for the power pins. The second one will be the SPI pins. And over here, right in the middle, we have the ICSP pins, but we're going to link it to the clock and the MOSI pin. And finally, we have 4 more pins, the same as Arduino Uno, the reset, the DC, the CS, and the busy pin. And these are all connected from D7 all the way to D10. And now once I plug in the USB, let's see. And yep, it is detecting. And when I visit my USB information in Mac, I can also see that Arduino M0 is detected. So why don't we flash it in with the makefile, watch the E-Ink screen. If the wiring and the firmware is all correct, it should display. And there you see, it says ePaper plus Uno, but of course it should be M0. So I'm just going to change it. And let's try to flash it in one more time. Watch the E-Ink screen. And there you see, it says ePaper plus M0, which means our pin connections were all correct. And And for the last development board, we will be using the Adafruit Feather Blue Fruit, which is made up of the microcontroller NRF52. And we will see that the pin connections from the Adafruit Feather board to the E-Ink screen is once again very, very similar. So we will start with the VCC and the ground pin. Once again, the VCC has to be connected to the 3.3 volts output pin. The next two easy ones are the clock and the MOSI, the SPI pins. And finally, there are the other four pins, the busy, the DC, the reset, and the CS, which we have connected to the A0 to A3 pins. Now, this is where we have to come to the firmware, the epdif.h file, where we have previously defined the Arduino M0 and Uno pins, but in this case, it has to be slightly different. So if we come to the pinout diagram of the Adafruit NRF52 board and we look at the IDE pin numbers, we can probably see that the purple color ones are the numbers that we can note in the IDE. We will take 2, 3, 4, 5, which correspond to A0 all the way to A3. So we are going to change it to 2, 3, 4, and 5. And maybe one tiny change in the firmware. Yes, instead of the previous one, why don't we write NRF52 to display on the E-Ink screen. So let's try it. I'm going to flash it in. And there you see it is refreshing. It has printed out NRF52, hello world. All right, so we have flashed in the firmware to display on the E-Ink on three different microcontrollers, and we saw the pin configuration. Hopefully, that will come in handy when we want to use the display itself onto a PCB. And as a last step, we will look into the SPI protocol using Logic Analyzer. Now, there's a lot of things happening right here on my table. And as you can see, it's really, really messy because we have this microcontroller. I'm using back Arduino M0 with SAMD21G. And there you have the E-Ink screen and the Logic Sally Analyzer. So I have opened up its software, the Logic Analyzer software version 2.1.3. And let's do some settings. And we will just use three channels here. And we will have a timer for about, say, 100 seconds. I will trigger it manually. But for the analyzer, I have chosen SPI. So for channel 0, I have connected it to the data in or the master out slave input pin. And for channel 1, it is the clock. And channel 2, it is the chip select or the enable pin. So I'm going to flash in and start the logic analyzer. And there you see it is recording. And we have stopped it. So let's zoom in and see what's going on here. I'm going to zoom into, say, some of the data that's being captured. And of course, in the analyzer, I have set it to decode as hexadecimal. So it has decoded the exact hexadecimal data that's going through. And this is how the clock looks like. It seems like it is having a period of about 0.5 microseconds. And this is also the chip select or the enable graph. It's pretty interesting to look at the signals if we probe through the SPI that we captured through the logic analyzer. I'm very, very excited about the E-Ink screen technology, especially because of its low power technology. And if we incorporate some kind of wireless protocol and write up some code, we can display any information or image that we want at a distance. So give it a go if you have a chance. It's pretty exciting. I am looking forward to integrating just the display onto a PCB project of mine. So thanks for watching, and I'll see you next time.